Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Faith, Freedom, and Future Ball. We're so glad you're with us tonight. As you're coming in to get your seats, I know some of you were wanting to get pictures. The photographers will be out there through the evening, so you can slip out and get your pictures a little bit later. Look, tonight, we're here to celebrate on several fronts. We're here to celebrate our constitutional republic and our freedom as Americans to choose our leaders. We saw that today. We're also here to celebrate that America has survived the onslaught of anti-faith, anti-freedom policies of the past 8 years. And America is still standing. And we celebrate an administration and a conservative majority in both the House and the Senate that are supportive of the biblical values that we hold dear. Now, let me just say, this is the first time that we have done an event like this, and admittedly, it is an overwhelming challenge. But in the days following the election, as our team huddled, we wanted to have a special event that would celebrate what had taken place in our nation. And we wanted to respond appropriately to the opportunity that's been given to us. An opportunity, I believe, for our nation to return to God. And so tonight, this is both an expression of our gratitude, thanking God for answering the prayers of His people, and giving us a chance to turn this country around. And then it's a chance to simply celebrate in the shadow of our nation's capital with friends from across the nation. So welcome tonight. We are so glad you're here with us. And we're delighted that of all the places you could be, you've decided to join us for what I believe is going to be an amazing evening of joy, of hope, of prayer, scripture reading, worship, and maybe a few laughs along the way. It's okay, conservatives, we can laugh occasionally. And we'll even have a little dancing for our non-Baptist friends. But first, let's join together and look to the one whom we humbly serve, the one who has truly preserved this great republic of ours. Please stand with me in the honor to, as we give honor to the reading of God's word for our theme scripture by the president of Let Freedom Ring USA, Colin Hanna, and then remain standing for our invocation and the blessing over tonight's dinner by David Barton, the founder and president of Wall Builders. Colin Hanna is a Navy veteran. He's the president of Let Freedom Ring. He's committed to promoting constitutional government, free enterprise, and traditional values. Colin is a former county commissioner in Pennsylvania, a CBS sales executive in New York, and a highly successful businessman and a great friend of the conservative movement. David Barton, one of America's foremost Christian historians that has helped us know as Christians what our history is in America and that we can take back that history so that we can determine America's future. Please welcome Colin Hanna.
Thank you, Tony. Our theme verse for the Faith, Freedom, and the Future Ball is Galatians 5:1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened by a yoke of slavery.
I like praying God's word, and I was thinking about what to pray. There were three or four scriptures just quickly crossed my mind. One is in Nehemiah where the people had a will to work. God gave them a willingness to work. One was out of Proverbs 22:21 where the scripture says a wise man attacks the stronghold of the mighty. He's offensive-minded. There is the one that Jesus gave in John. He said, look, when the light comes on you, you walk right then, lest darkness overtake you. You have a window of opportunity. Use that window of opportunity. And what's happened with this election is we've not reversed the decline of the culture, but we have hit the pause button. And so while we expect the president and Congress to really do some aggressive things, we've got to as well. We've got to change the culture. We don't get to rest. We have to get after this. So we're going to pray for our leaders, those in authority. We're going to pray for our food, but let's pray for ourselves as well, that we get reinvigorated, reengaged, that we get aggressive and get in the culture fight with a new vigor. Father, we thank you for the celebration we have tonight. We thank you for the period of reprieve that you've given us, Father, that we do get a chance to turn this around, that the decline is at least paused for now. And so, Father, we pray for the president, we pray for the vice president, we pray for the House and the Senate. Lord, that we would become offensive-minded, that we would go on the offense, be able to roll back. And even today, Lord, I rejoice that we were at an inauguration where people actually got to pray in Jesus' name. How long has that been? Just so we're already seeing things change, but Father, give us the same boldness we want to see in our leaders, Father. Let us go after social media and our neighbors and our friends, and let us be aggressive proclaiming the truths and the principles and the things that need to happen. Father, thank you for the grace you've given us. Pray for courage for our leaders, courage for ourselves, and we thank you for the food we have tonight. Father, bless it, and Father, also bless all the hands who prepared it. We ask that in Jesus' name, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, David. Always wanted to do that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, how are you enjoying the evening so far? Well, we're only halfway there. We have a wonderful evening planned for you. But I first want to recognize, if I can have your attention, you don't want to miss it. I want to recognize all of our sponsors. You know, I think we learned in this election that we are so much more effective when we work together. I think that sounds like a biblical concept, does it not? Well, tonight, we're able to be here and celebrate this great victory and have a wonderful evening together as a result of partnership. And tonight, I want to recognize our co-sponsors and some others who are our special guests tonight. But I want to do this before I recognize our sponsors. Help me once again to thank the Doc Dykeman Big Band. Aren't they great? Wonderful job tonight. Thank you, guys. And we're not finished with them. They're not going anywhere. But I want to recognize our sponsors who helped us make tonight available. First, American Values, Council for National Policy, Faith and Freedom Coalition, Gateway Church, Let Freedom Ring, Life Today with James and Betty Robinson, Tea Party Patriots, and Wall Builders. Let's thank all of our sponsors for making tonight possible. I also want to thank Jensen Franklin for being the sponsor of our reception tonight. Jensen, thank you for sponsoring that reception this evening. Now I'd like to recognize all of our military veterans that are here tonight. All of our military veterans, would you please stand? Ladies and gentlemen, you made tonight possible. Thank you for your service to our country. And we have some other distinguished guests with us tonight. I'd like to recognize the Attorney General for the state of Texas, Ken Paxton, his wife Angela are here. Thank you for being here. We have some great attorney generals working across the country. And I don't know if he's here, but Scott Pruitt from Oklahoma was going to pass by. He's also the nominee for EPA Administrator, going to be a great administrator for EPA. A couple great champions from Capitol Hill that are with us tonight, Robert Adderholt and his wife Caroline from Alabama. Robert, thank you. And one of the newest members to Congress from my home state of Louisiana, we have Mike and Kelly Johnson. Mike Johnson from the 3rd District, 4th District. And now, I would like to ask you to rise to your feet for our Pledge of Allegiance, which is going to be led by Jenny Beth Martin, the president and the co-founder for Tea Party Patriots Foundation. I want you to remain standing for the singing of our national anthem, which is going to be performed by Yolanda Pleasure Parker. And she is a former vocalist with the U.S. Navy Commodore's Jazz Ensemble. So you'll be in for a treat. Under the leadership of Jenny Beth, Tea Party Patriots has grown to be the largest and most effective national umbrella group within the Tea Party movement. Because of her continual involvement in the major events that set the course for the U.S. government, Jenny Beth is a frequent guest on almost every major television and radio, print, and online news outlet in the country. In 2010, Time magazine listed Jenny Beth Martin as one of the 100 most influential leaders in America. Please welcome Jenny Beth Martin.
Great day to make America great again. Please join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Thank you, Yolanda. You may be seated. And now we're going to ask Gary Bauer, the President of American Values, to come, followed by the Honorable Bob McEwen, Executive Director for the Council for National Policy, for a reading and prayer. So they'll make their way to the stage. Gary is no stranger to this crowd. He is a true pioneer in the conservative and the Christian movement as a leading spokesman for pro-life, pro-family, and pro-growth values. He was the chief domestic policy advisor to President Ronald Reagan. He was the president of the Family Research Council, and in 2000, he ran for president of the United States. Today, he serves as the chairman of the Campaign for Working Families PAC, American Values, and the director of Christians United for the Israel Action Fund. Bob McEwen, during his service in Congress as a representative from the great state of Ohio, he was elected by his colleagues to the two most coveted positions, the Select Committee on Intelligence, which oversees all of our nation's secrets, and the powerful House Committee on Rules, which has jurisdiction over all legislation in Congress. In addition to serving as the Executive Director of the Council for National Policy, he and his wife Liz are frequent speakers at family life marriage conferences throughout the United States and Canada. Please welcome Gary Bauer and Bob McEwen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. What an incredible night, folks. Wouldn't it be neat to go around to each table? And no, Tony, I'm not going to do that. But wouldn't it be great to go around to each table and ask what it is would be the number one or number two or number three thing you would hope that this new government would do in the months ahead? And I think we can think of a lot of those things, life, family, et cetera, religious liberty. I would hope one of the things that would be on the list is a restoration between the great alliance between the United States and Israel. You know, our forefathers, our founding fathers on the way to Constitution Hall were well-read men. And on the way to Constitution Hall, they found the ideas of our republic in the Torah and in the New Testament. It was there they found the ideas that liberty comes not from government, but from God, that we're made in the image of God, that it doesn't matter what the color of your skin is or how much money you have in the bank or whether you're a newborn with Down syndrome or a 95-year-old with senility, you have dignity and value and worth because you were made by that God. Judeo-Christian civilization is built on that idea. I want to share two verses with you, one for America, from Psalms 33, 11 to 12. The plans of the Lord stand firm forever. The purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And then a verse dedicated to Israel. Pray for the peace of Israel. They shall prosper that love you. Psalms 122, 6. God bless you.
Thank you, Gary. June 28th, 1787, at the invitation of George Washington, 13 colonies had met for a month and a half to establish a constitution, and they could agree upon absolutely nothing. 50% of the people lived in three states, 50% lived in 10 states. There's no way around that. As they began to break apart, it was apparent that it wasn't going to work. This great dream that they had had, that this nation could be formed. One of the four signers of the Declaration that had met in that same room 11 years earlier asked to speak for the first time. And Benjamin Franklin said, "Mr. President, the small progress that we have made after 4 or 5 weeks is proof of the imperfection of human understanding. We've gone back to ancient history for models of ancient government, examined the different forms which now no longer exist. We have viewed modern states all around Europe, but none of their constitutions are suitable to our circumstances. In this situation, groping in the dark to find political truth, we have not once thought of humbly applying to the Father of Lights to illuminate our understanding." In other words, we've been crawling around here in the dark and nobody has bothered to go over and turn on the lights. In the beginning of the contest with Great Britain, we had daily prayer in this room for divine protection. Our prayers were heard and they were graciously answered. And have we now forgotten this powerful friend, or do we imagine that we no longer need his assistance? Sir, I've lived a long time. The longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men. If a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it probable that an empire could rise without his aid? I've been assured in the sacred writings that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain to build it. Well, I firmly believe this, that without his concurring aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the builders of Babel. I therefore move that prayers imploring the assistance of heaven and its blessing on our deliberations be held in this assembly every morning before we proceed to business. With that, they recessed for 3 days of fasting and prayer, met the following Monday on their knees, and over the next 5 weeks, they wrote the Constitution of the United States, creating the oldest government on the planet, establishing the system that we celebrated today, writing the very words that were quoted from that occasion. And they said, they need to understand from whence this came. Therefore, Congress shall never meet without first calling upon God in prayer. If the House meets tomorrow for 1 minute to take a message from the Senate, the Speaker will bang the gavel. They will ask God's blessing, they'll receive the message, and then adjourn. In the United States of America, the Congress has never met without first calling upon God in prayer. Number two, every position of public trust, a person shall first swear allegiance with one standard, the Bible, and then on every official document, whether they be declaring Groundhog Day, it doesn't matter, at the end of the document, it shall say, done in this the year of our Lord, the 2017th, of the independence of the United States of America, the 234th. And that nation has created more wealth than all previous history of mankind. For thousands of years, people hoped to fly. That nation, 4% of the population of the world, created the airplane and the light bulb and the telegraph and the telephone and the global positioning system and put men on the moon and the internet. That nation, more books, more plays, more symphonies, more copyrights, more inventions, more Nobel Prizes than the rest of the world combined. Now why? We have chosen to abandon those principles, but by God's grace, Sarah Silverstone, one Silverstone from Hollywood, tweeted in a few hours ago that she heard the name of Jesus Christ more today than she had ever heard in her entire life. Gary mentioned it. I will bless those who bless you and curse those that curse you, and in all the families of the earth they shall be blessed. Christians are being decapitated at this moment because we failed in our leadership, the choices that we made. We're going to amend that. We've seen what had happened to Israel in just the last few weeks. We're going to amend that. And now we're going to ask God's blessing. Now we're going to go, as our founders suggested, to understand from whence our strength comes and to ask his blessing on this nation. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we recognize that it was not by the might of our political organization. It was not by the power of our persuasive arguments, but it was by your Spirit that you chose new leadership for our nation, and for that we say thank you. And now, Lord, we look to you as the source of wisdom. You said, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not. And so, as we begin this effort, we thank you, we rejoice, we express utmost gratitude for what you have done to protect and preserve this nation. And now we ask your wisdom and encouragement to those assembled here, that we may lift up our leaders to do what is righteous in your eyes. And all that is accomplished, we will give praise to your Son, who is our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Gary. Well, I'm going to encourage you, if you have not yet turned your chair around, go ahead and get comfortable. We're going to get into some toe-tapping here in just a moment. That's a term we use in the South. That means have a good time, okay? So go ahead and get comfortable, because if not, you might have to get a chiropractor later. I think we have one in the room, but you'll have to listen to his jokes if you go see Dr. Alan Unruh. Coming now, you may recognize this name, Guy Penrod. He is a Grammy, Dove, Gold, and Platinum Award-winning recording artist and the former lead singer of the Gaither Vocal Band. Guy has toured all over the world for over 20 years, appearing live in front of over 15 million people and counting. That's 15.1 million tonight. And he and his wife, Angie, are dedicated believers and express to me how thankful they are for the groups and the individuals in this room that work to strengthen family, to strengthen faith and family and freedom in our country. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Guy Penrod.
We lift your name, Jesus. You know it, sing it.
In the valley of the shadow of death, you reign.
Crank it up.
Through every storm and fiery test, you reign. Over the cross and the powers of hell, you reign. And inside the loneliest prison cell, you reign.
You believe that?
And the oceans deep, sing it with me. Over the rivers and the oceans deep, you reign.
Can y'all use a little more volume in this room? Crank it up a little bit more.
You never slumber and you never sleep, you reign.
Hallelujah. I like this line right here.
Kings and queens may wear a crown, but you reign.
Yeah.
And in the end, when it all comes down, you reign.
Yes, you do.
You reign. You reign. You reign.
Your kingdom will last forever. Sing it.
Your king.
All right, I think you know it now. And I have to sing after I eat, so you guys join me. Let's do the first verse again. In the valley of the shadow of death. Here we go.
In the valley of the shadow of death, you reign.
Through every storm and fiery test, you reign, Lord.
Through every storm and fiery test, you reign.
Over the cross and the powers of hell.
Over the cross and the powers of hell, you reign, yeah. And inside the loneliest prison cell, you reign. Your kingdom will last forever.
Sing it.
You reign. Your kingdom will last forever. You reign. Your kingdom will last forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, 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 ever. Your kingdom will last forever.
Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Hallelujah. Well, I've used my time. Oh, you're going to let me sing it anyway. All right. Matthew chapter 6 teaches us not to worry, but to pray about it. Give it to God, right?
Time is tight and money's short. River's up and the weatherman, he's calling for another storm. Pressure's on, margin's thin. Gotta figure out a fix for this awful fix I'm in. Oh, mama, what am I gonna do? And she said, child, there's only one thing you can do. Don't worry about nothing. Let it go, see what tomorrow brings. Don't worry about nothing, pray about everything. Love is blind, fate don't care. Lose your grip and your balloons go sailing off into the air. Oh mama, what am I gonna do? And she said, child, there's only one thing you can do. Hey, don't worry about nothing. Just let it go, see what tomorrow brings. Don't worry about nothing, pray about everything.
Yeah, pray about everything.
Oh, take a walk, take a breath. Give it all a rest. Take a paintball to the fishing hole and catch a couple of fish.
And just like that, toss them back.
Make a little wish. Pray about everything.
Yeah!
Don't worry about nothing.
Not a thing.
Just let it go, see what tomorrow brings. Don't worry about it, stress about it, fret about it. No, don't worry about nothing. Hey, let it go, see what tomorrow brings. Don't worry about nothing. Pray about everything.
Yeah, pray about
everything.
Ladies and gentlemen, Guy Penrod. You got to be flexible in this city. Well, next we have Emmy-nominated and best-selling comedian Shonda Pierce. She's been making audiences laugh for more than two decades with her winning combination of fierce wit and southern charm. Last year, she won the Best Documentary Award at the 2016 Park City International Film Festival with her first film, Shonda Pierce, Laughing in the Dark. It's based on her personal struggle to overcome depression. When asked why she was excited to be a part of the festivities this week here in D.C., she said, "I am a proud American and honored to be a part in anything that celebrates our freedom and our traditions as Americans." Please welcome comedian, television hostess, author, Shonda Pierce.
I cannot believe we get to do this. And just to do it with you, I think you should stay out here and like be the best straight man.
I'm pretty straight.
I brought like four tracks we could sing. That really made him nervous.
Well, that guy is now being forced to watch MSNBC for the rest of the night.
Oh, my goodness. That's terrible. Right. You should at least make him watch CNN. Right. So, this is the truth. I got all dressed up. I feel like Cinderella. And I got three pair of Spanx on, so I'm not even sure I can breathe.
Spanx?
Spanx. Spanx. Now, your wife is tiny, so evidently you don't know what Spanx are.
Well, help me.
And I don't like her all that much. There are some skinny now, girls in here that I know don't go to a Baptist church. So,
you're talking about a girdle.
It's a girdle, yes. Oh. And I gave up Spanx in Afghanistan. That's where I left my Spanx last time I was in Afghanistan.
I think I may have found it.
Where?
General Boykin? Aren't you here?
He's not even laughing.
It's because his Spanx is too tight.
Exactly. Tony Perkins, everybody. Is he like the best straight man in the universe? I did get all dressed up for this, and it took three fairy godmothers to zip this dress. I already took my shoes off and threw them on the steps. So if, Prince Charming or Romeo comes at me with those high heel shoes, I'll slap him. In Jesus' name. I really did give up my Spanx in Afghanistan. I know it's a strange place to give up Spanx, but if you are walking in that Afghanistan sand with your Spanx on and you have a hot flash, I have a rash the government is still trying to identify. And I feel very, very blessed to have gotten to go anyway, because I went on a USO trip and that was wonderful. But, you know, sometimes when you're a born-again Christian and people find that out and you're a stand-up comedian, that surprises them. I don't know why. As a preacher's kid, I've stolen so many preachers' jokes. It's how I got a career. And so I just report all the dumb things y'all have been doing. And so, and I appreciate the material. I need to tell y'all that. And so I went, and then I went in this room, and this girl, she just rolls her eyes. She goes, "Oh, you're our comedian this year, and you're a born-again Christian? How does that work?" And I said, very carefully, because my manager has lightning. And so I would shut it in Jesus' name. And so, if you say in Jesus' name after anything, you could get by with a lot. And so I went. Now, it's a thrill to go anywhere with the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders because we have so much in common. And because they wear spandex, too. That's all they wear. But I kept mine under my clothes. And so we're on this airplane, and General, you would probably know what kind it is. You could put, like, this whole hotel in an airplane. It was huge. It was dynamic, and it was just, I mean, and we had, like, a line of porta-potties, which nothing is too good for the armed services. And so, don't get me started. So, this big hotshot from the Pentagon got on the loudspeaker and said, now you all might want to get fixed up. We're going to stop and have a photo shoot on the tarmac when we land in Kuwait City. And he looked at me when he said it. And I thought I had fixed up. Evidently, I had a ways to go because those girls, they got out the hair curlers and the curling irons and the lipstick and the lip liner and the eyebrow pencil. They just draw your face and then you fill in the cracks. And there they were. They were just getting at it. And so I'm feeling inadequate. I had a tube of chapstick and some baby powder. We're going to a war zone. Revlon's not going to help you. And so I caved to the peer pressure, girls, and I went in that bathroom and I got out my Spanx. Now, if you've ever tried to put on a pair of Spanx in an airplane bathroom, my body moved in ways. I mean, it was like a Pentecostal conniption. I was pulling and tugging and trying to get my Spanx on, and my thumb went through my Spanx, and I thought I had a tumor. It scared me to death. I don't know if you have ever tried to get the dough back in a Pillsbury can. So then I just had to put on another pair on top of that pair to get the tumor in, and... And so we finally, you know, and we had a wonderful trip. It was really, really wonderful. We were in Iraq for like a week or so, and we were staying at a hotel that used to be a palace, and now it's a hotel. And I don't know, you know, I go to a Pentecostal church, so I carry olive oil with me everywhere. Because you don't know when you're going to run out of salad dressing or need to anoint something, because... We use all-purpose oil at our church. And so I was in Iraq. Now, I'm telling you, I wouldn't want to offend any Episcopalians here, but you've been drinking already, so it don't matter. I just had to get that in. So there I was, and I was staying in this room where I'd heard these horrible things had happened, and so I decided while the cheerleaders were out, doing what they do, and I decided I would pray over my room, and I would anoint the doorpost, I would anoint my bed, and I would just, you know, the door jamb, and I just praying the glory down, and that, Lord, you know, there are evil things in this world, and don't let them get up. And I don't know if you've ever done something kind of churchy, and people that aren't kind of churchy catch you doing something churchy. You can have so much fun with that. And so I began to pray. Now, Lord, these girls have just poked their head because they were poking their head around the corner. I said, and they have heard me praying. Now, Lord, we could have a lot of fun with this. And I'm pretty sure I heard him say, go for it. And so I was like, and Lord, we know there's evil in this world, and it will jump out in these walls in the middle of the night and choke us till we cannot breathe at all. And I knew they were scared because their knees were knocking. I could hear the bones clicking. It was absolutely hysterical, and I did have a wonderful time, and I went through all Afghanistan, Iraq, Kuwait. I had the greatest understanding and knowledge that I never dreamed I would have as a little preacher's kid from the South of how our military works. And it's funny, my pastor had highlighted a lot of places in my Bible where he knew we would be flying over so I could study and see and just know what things looked like in the terrain. And it was just a beautiful experience. And we got on one of those Black Hawk helicopters that kind of swish when you fly in them. Y'all got to fly like this back and forth so that the people from the ground can't shoot you. And I've seen preachers drive through Dallas like that. And you know, you're flying like this, and it is so funny. And when you're just feeling a little down and persecuted as an entertainer, and they're like, she's the clean comic, blah, blah, and, you know, you're flying like, so I just mind my own business, read my Bible, and then we took on fire. And everybody cozies up to the Christian. Because I was bigger than all those girls, so they could hide right behind me. But it was a trip. What a trip. Let me tell you about another trip in the Middle East. It was amazing. You have not lived till you take about 45 of your closest high school friends, Tennessee rednecks, to the Bubba is in the Basilica of Jerusalem. We took all these rednecks to Israel, and it was so much fun. And you know, when you're over there and you want to see where Jesus was, but sometimes the guides will want to tell you where Moses was, and we're like, that's good, that's wonderful, but was Jesus right here? Because I'm going to put these rocks in my purse. Was Jesus there? And, you know, you empty your shampoo bottle so you could put sand in there and then give it to your preacher like you brought him something. And you know, then I had these little bottles. I put water from the Red Sea. I put water in there to take to my preacher, and then it leaked in my... And so, don't ever tell him. I just filled it up with tap water. It is sitting on his desk, this little pretty vial. And I have doubled my tithe so that nobody will know. I gave him tap water out of the Stones River in Tennessee. And so, it was a beautiful trip. And I'm not going to waste your time trying to be all theological, because obviously I've blown that already. But we went to Bethany, and that was incredible. We all clammed into this little tiny tomb so we could holler, "Someone stinketh." And because Lazarus had done that. And we went to Jericho, and we jumped out and ran around the bus and blew, and nothing happened. So I was worried about my faith. And then we went to this place, this amazing place where religious people, where spiritual people, where every church takes turns in a line, standing close to each other, excited about one place on the planet. And we stood in line for hours. And my feet were killing me, and we walked for days. And I'm not Jesus, so I don't like to walk. But we got in this long line, and we went around this little bend where it turns, and you go up this little staircase, and you finally get to the place where one by one we took turns, and we knelt down as close as we could and put our hand in a little piece of plexiglass so that we could touch the spot where someone said, "Jesus Christ, the cross of Golgotha went right here." And I began to sob, because that is where freedom began for me. Praise his name for fun and faith and family and freedom. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shonda. Aaron and Amanda Crabb. Aaron is a part of the Crabb family, one of the most celebrated family groups to grace the stage, whose legacy includes 15 number one songs, multiple Grammy nominations, and 11 Dove Awards. For 5 years, Amanda and Aaron were worship leaders at Pastor John Hagee's Cornerstone Church in San Antonio, Texas. But in 2014, God led them to return their family in Nashville to plant a church. Today, they pastor Restoring Hope Church in Nashville, Tennessee, and continue to bless the world with their music. Would you please welcome Aaron and Amanda Crabb?
Amen, amen. Guy, awesome job, my brother. Awesome job. Would you agree? How many knows that we serve a God of restoration? From Genesis to Revelation, he's a God of restoration. And it's all because of his blood. Amen? Hallelujah.
Your blood is a rescue to the sin-stained life. Your blood is healing to the hopeless and broken. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough. Your blood is a shelter In the middle of my storm, your blood is my refuge. When I'm hurting and alone,
your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough. It's renewing, restoring, saving and healing, delivering captives, setting us free. It is life everlasting to all who receive it, your blood.
Enough, Lord.
It's more than enough.
I believe it, Lord.
Your blood is a rescue to the sin-stained life. Your blood is healing to the hopeless and broken. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough.
I believe it, Lord.
Your blood is a shelter in the middle of my storm. Your blood is my refuge when I'm hurting and alone. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough.
I believe in Lord.
Come on, lift your hands and say,
renewing, restoring, saving and healing, delivering, counting, setting us free. It is life everlasting to all who receive it, your blood.
To heal you tonight, oh,
it's more than enough,
more than enough to deliver,
it's more than enough,
Jesus, oh yes it is, Lord,
it's more than enough.
Enough to restore our nation, Lord.
It's more than enough.
We love you, Lord. We worship and say,
it's more than enough.
Come on, how many is thankful for the blood of Jesus tonight? Come on, no man comes to the Father except through him, and that has through the blood of Jesus. I've been asked to share a brief portion of my testimony tonight. Aaron and I count it an honor to be here and worship and celebrate what this day truly represents to us as Americans. Amen. How grateful for the restoring power of God. I'm reminded of Joel 2:25. I will restore the years that the creeping, the crawling, the chewing locusts have eaten. And it's time, and I'm excited to see the church rise up in full restoration power of Jesus Christ. My testimony is that the beginning ages of 5 years old, I began to suffer abuse from different men in my life. And that went on until I was 9 years old. So you can imagine those adolescent years, I begin to carry, this must be all that I am. If God is who he says he is, then where is he? How could he allow these horrible things to come upon a child? Have you ever asked the Lord why? I know we're not supposed to do that, but Jesus did it on the cross. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And I remember I went on through my teenage years carrying it. I met this man at the age of 19, and we are rushing through this, but I want to get to the point and the good stuff. You see, so many times we focus on the bad, and God's saying, if you will give me the glory, you will see the full restoration in your life. Because you see, we had been married for 2 years, and I said, God, if you don't do something in my life, I'm out. And God sent an angel my way in the form of a woman who told me everything about my life that I had never spoken to another human being. I laid in a stranger's lap at a Crab Family concert and wept for 2 solid hours. And she said, now that you have emptied yourself of all of that junk, I'm going to pray that God fills every crack and every crevice of your being so as much that the devil will regret the day that he ever messed with you. So we have been telling this testimony for 12 years on the road and all over the world and now at our church in Restoring Hope. And I'm thankful to know the restoration power of God. And I'm not ashamed of what he did in my life. You see, that does not define who I am, but it only shows the restoring power of God Almighty. Amen. And I'm excited to see what God is going to do. We've been declaring that 2017 is the year of restoration. So tonight, as we close with this song, I pray that it blesses you. It's a song that the Lord allowed me to sit down at the piano and write, and it simply says, "Restore me." You know my doubts and you know my fears. You know the story behind every tear. You held me close as I pushed you away. Why has it been so hard for me to say? I need your grace. I need your mercy. I need your love to come. Palm of my hand. I was there when you heard or even questioned why. So open up your heart. I've been here the whole time. I am
your grace.
I am your grace. I am.
God bless you.
Aaron and Amanda, thank you so much. You know, God is a God of restoration. He restores individuals, but he also restores nations. And I am praying that we do see that restoration of our nation. But it requires, as Amanda just testified, that we cry out to him. And I believe that's what we have seen in recent months in America, that we've cried out to God. But we must continue to seek his face, that we might see him heal our land again. But continuing tonight, Cody Carnes and Carrie Job, our husband and wife worship leaders, and gifted songwriters from Nashville with a passion to lead people into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Carrie has more than 1 million albums sold, a Grammy nomination, and multiple Dove Awards. She has amassed 173 million career streams and is the most followed female Christian contemporary artist on social media. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Carrie Job and Cody Carnes.
Wow, what an honor to be here tonight. And this is my husband, Cody. I like for my name to be Carrie Job Carnes, because really I'm Mrs. Carnes now. It's my greatest honor. But as he gets set up tonight, man, this is just such a beautiful day. And I think one of the many amazing moments today for me was watching the armed forces lining the streets waiting for the president to come by. And I started to tear up as I saw that, because it was just so moving and so honoring to watch them slowly salute the president as he went by. And I just started thinking about those of you that are sitting in this room tonight, that for me, you're like armed forces. You've gone before, you've paved the way for my generation. You've sown in tears. You've planted seeds. You've watered those seeds for years and years. And I'm honored tonight. I feel like you're the spiritual armed forces of the world. And I salute you tonight. It is an honor to lead you in worship for a few minutes.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord,
Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome.
we pray to you, humble ourselves again. Lord, would you hear our cry? Lord, will you heal our land? That every eye would see, that every heart will know, the one who took our sin, the one who died and rose. So God, we pray to you, humble ourselves again. Lord, would you hear our cry? Lord, will you heal our land? That every eye will see, that every heart will know, the one who took our sin, the one who died and rose. And when your kingdom,
you know, this past Easter last year, we were at home and I was sitting on my couch on Good Friday about 10 o'clock at night. And every Easter, I just like to take time that weekend to be just especially reverent for that, for what that is, and Jesus on the cross. And I remember I was sitting on the couch that this particular year, just heavy-hearted because one of the big ISIS attacks had just happened. And, you know, I'm just sitting there with God and just processing all of this and trying to find the hope in it. And the Holy Spirit came to me and just spoke one line that just put me on the floor. It said, the cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. And I remember I just began to cry and ran to the piano, and that night I was up till about 3 a.m. I remember Carrie came in about 1 a.m. and said, what are you doing? Like, it's time to come to bed. I said, I have to just get this out. And so it's become this song that we're releasing now this year into the world. And I just believe that it's a hope declaration. You know, this is true for every situation, not only in politics, not only in Washington, D.C., but for whatever you're facing. If it's a disease, if it's a hardship, if it's a relational thing, whatever you're facing, the hope that we stand on today, every single one of us in this room, is that the cross has the final word. Amen? This is final word.
The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. Sorrow may come in the darkest night, but the cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. Evil may put up its strongest fight, but the cross has the final word.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. There's nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final. Come with the morning light. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. The cross has the final word. He traded death for eternity. Nothing stronger, nothing higher, nothing greater than the name of Jesus. All the honor, all the power, all the glory to the name of Jesus.
Stars they wept, the morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
Yeah.
And we're going to have the privilege to hear from them again in just a little bit. But first, you know, we cannot leave here tonight without looking at Scripture. And I believe Scripture speaks to us where we are right now and where we need to go. And we've celebrated, but we've got work to do. And I want to bring to the stage now Ralph Reed. He is the founder and chairman of Faith and Freedom Coalition. He was a senior advisor in the Bush-Cheney campaigns in both 2000 and 2004. As the executive director of the Christian Coalition from 1989 to 1997, he built one of the most effective public policy organizations in recent political history. And he comes now to share a scripture and comments. Please welcome Mr. Ralph Reed.
Have y'all had fun today? You know, today, we're not just celebrating. Today, whether we watched on television or we were there at the west front of the Capitol, we truly witnessed a miracle. And by that, I don't just mean the extremely unlikely occurrence of Donald J. Trump being inaugurated as President of the United States. I don't just mean that when the pollsters and the pundits and the press and when everyone dismissed him as a clown who couldn't win, that today it was him addressing the nation in his inaugural address. What I'm really referring to is the miracle of America and the peaceful transition of power that occurred today. As a man rose to the highest office in the land, shaking the hand and commending his predecessor. This is not only unusual in the annals of human history, it is unusual on the planet today. The rest of the world experiences genocide, bloodshed, civil unrest, persecution, almost unspeakable poverty. Over 500,000 innocents dead in just Syria alone. We live in a nation of peace and prosperity. And the reason is because this nation was built on faith in Almighty God. And the two scriptures that I'm going to read as we head towards the close of the program and before the band comes out for more dancing really speaks to that principle. The first is Psalm 127, verse 1. Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain. And from 1 Corinthians 15, 58. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you, Ralph. Tonight, our hearts are filled with gratitude toward God. I believe that he has heard our prayers and he has granted us a reprieve as a nation. But the future remains unknown. But we're grateful to have the prospects of a future, given what we've seen in recent years. We're thankful for the part that each one of you have played in getting us to this point, a point where I believe many Americans once again not only hope that America can be great again, but I actually believe they believe America can be great again. A nation of opportunity, a nation of justice, and a nation that is ruled by the law. The Bible in the book of Proverbs illuminates the path to greatness for a nation. It says, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. To be a great nation, we must be a good nation. But government can never make us good. Only God, working in each of our hearts, can accomplish such a task. And this is why religious freedom is so intertwined with America's future success. We must be free to pursue God and obey God. And as Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And that's why I believe our charge here tonight as we leave in a little while, we go back to our homes, our respective communities. We must now work with President Trump and Vice President Pence, who have pledged to restore America's religious freedom. And that's not just the freedom to attend the particular church of your choice on a Sunday morning. Religious freedom is the ability to live our lives according to our faith. We have an opportunity. But as Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. Tonight we celebrate. Tomorrow we rise from our knees after our time of prayer to do the works of righteousness in America so that our nation can be a nation that God can and will bless again. Coming now to give us a charge in prayer is Pastor Robert Morris. He is the founding senior pastor of Gateway Church, a multi-campus church in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. Since it began in 2000, the church has grown to more than 36,000 active members. He is featured on the daily television program, The Blessed Life. He serves as the chairman of the board of the King's University. He is a best-selling author of 14 books. Would you please help me welcome Pastor Robert Morris.
Well, I want to just encourage us for a moment tonight to do what we need to do going forward. And that's what many of us have been doing that brought us to this wonderful day, and that's to pray. But I want to give you a little tidbit that might help you understand how important it is to pray. There's another word in the Bible for prayer that is a word you're familiar with. It's intercession. But many times we don't know what these words mean or where they came from. And the word intercession, to help you, is there's an English word that's almost identical to it in its meaning. And that's the word intersection. It's where two roads meet. And that's what it actually means in the Bible, matter of fact. In the Old Testament, many times the word intercession is actually describing the borders of the promised land, where two roads meet, and it uses the word the intercession or the intersection. So what I want to tell you is that what brought us to this day is all the hard work, all the giving, all the things that we did in the natural, but really what brought us to this day was that the church, for the first time in a long time, came together and prayed for our nation. But here's the problem. Many times if the candidate that we don't like gets elected, then we don't pray for him, because we don't like him. And then if the one that we like gets elected, we don't pray because we think, well, we got the right guy, and he'll do the right thing. And I believe Donald Trump is the right guy, but he won't do the right thing without our help and without God's help. And so what we do when we pray is we reach up with one hand and we grab hold of God, and we reach out with the other hand in the spiritual and we grab hold of Donald J. Trump and we intersect him with God every day, every day. And this is actually what it means when it says Jesus is at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. I don't want to burst your bubble, but he's not up there, as Shonda was saying, in Jesus' name to his Father praying for us. He's actually has the Father with one hand. He has us with the other hand, and he brings us into an encounter with his Holy Father. And so I want us to pray, and I just want to give you a charge that we need to continue to pray for our president, for our vice president, for our congressmen and women, for our elected officials. 1 Timothy says, I wish men everywhere would pray, and I want them to pray for the governing authorities. So will you join me in prayer as we intersect God and our government? Lord, we want to tell you we are so grateful for today. Lord, we sensed in our spirits that something has changed in the heavenlies today. Not just something on earth, but something in the heavenlies changed today. And so, Lord, we ask you to anoint our president with your Holy Spirit. Lord, to guide his mind and his heart. Lord, we ask you to give him wisdom as you gave Solomon wisdom. And Lord, we ask you that you would bring about a spiritual revival in our nation, and that the church that came together in this election would continue to come together and be light and salt to America and then to the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
It has been so good to have you with us tonight. We are so grateful that you have chosen to spend this evening with us. as we have sought to honor the Lord in all that we have done here tonight, expressing our gratitude to Him, expressing our commitment to finish the work that has begun in this nation. And I cannot think of anyone better to pray us out of here tonight, or we still have time, maybe pray us onto the dance floor, is my good friend James Robinson. For more than 50 years, James has delivered the gospel as an evangelist through the founding of Life Outreach International, missions, outreaches, and through his television broadcast that he hosts with his wife, Betty. Next month, they will be celebrating 54 years of marriage. Betty, you are a saint. There are few men that God has ever raised up in the history of the church who have reached and won more people to Christ through all his various ministries. There are few people that are more passionate than James Robinson. Please welcome James Robinson.
Great hand for what he's done for us, not only tonight, but continually. We don't have a greater representative with the media for the church and for the Lord Jesus. He mentioned Betty. Let me ask Betty to stand before the rest of you do. Would you stand over here, Betty? I can't see you for the spotlight, but maybe folks can see you. 54 years. And I've got to tell you this, in humor, the morning after the president was elected, I've been able to call him for 10 months at virtually any time and talk and pray. And we've done that consistently for 10 months. It's been a marvelous journey. But after he was elected, I thought, well, let's see if he's still talks to somebody now that he's president-elect. And he did, and we had an incredible conversation. He asked me to be certain that he never forgot what I'd shared with him for 10 months, that you need to be surrounded with wisdom, with prayer, with love. And you're the only one that can cut it off. You're the only one that can keep it coming. And he said firmly, surround me, and don't ever let me forget it. And my wife was listening because I knew it was a historic moment. I had the phone on, and she actually recorded. And after he said that, then he said, and tell your wife, Betty, she's a saint, because it's the only way she could live with you. I want to say this in behalf of the president. We talked at length Sunday. It was one of the most wonderful visits I've ever had with him. And he wanted so to come here. They had really limited the balls that he would attend, because it's a very unsettled condition. We actually rode with Secret Service in our van this morning, our bus, and we were the president's guests for the meeting this morning, which I was to preach to him, pray for him and his family, the cabinet and Vice President Pence. They were all there. It was a wonderful occasion. And they wouldn't let us go where we were told to go. And he's Secret Service talking to Secret Service. Well, I got a text from Eric because all through the day, we've been going back and forth. The president wanted to come here. He thought it'd make a great impression to say God's first, faith's first, prayer's first. And he wanted to come here. And Eric actually said, I think we're just going to have to say, swing by. And so he texted at 9:03 and said, we're just now leaving the White House. We're an hour behind. We got three balls. And I don't think it's going to happen. But I wanted to let you know he wanted to come. He really did. And no way to express adequately the appreciation he has for those who really took prayer seriously. And what you've heard from Tony, what you just heard from Pastor Robert Morris, that's what we need to do. So I believe you're going to be consistent in doing that and stand together as the body of Christ to literally see the government on his shoulders, just as the kingdom family is also. Would you stand together and let's close in prayer? If you could take the hand of those next to you, just join with a few people. You don't have to try to connect everybody, but let's just be family. Hasn't this been a great occasion tonight? Gifted people committed to the Lord. It is so beautiful to behold. Father, we want to thank you from the depth of our heart for preventing us from seeing judgment shift into high gear, and the catastrophic consequences of many years of casting aside your word, changing your truth into a lie, and finding ourselves bound by uncontrollable, even unnatural appetites. And then leading to a reprobate mind where we can't even seem to determine night from day, right from wrong, good from evil. God, would you deliver us from evil? And Lord, would you raise up the church to be the family that looks like you, the perfect Father? Would you please bring us together, connected to one another, appreciating each unique, diverse part, and all of us together submitting to the one head, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we ask you for the miracle of the next great spiritual awakening in our lifetime. And may you receive the glory and the honor forever and ever. Amen.
The sea, let us pledge allegiance to a land that's free.
Let us all be grateful for a land so fair.
Join us with one rousing chorus.
Continue to enjoy the music, and we hope you have a wonderful time here tonight. God bless you.
love me.
Thank you so much. Thanks for being here. Guy, thank you, man.
Great program.